Hello everyone, I'm Xiaoqing and I'm an application geoscientist from Paradigm based in Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia. First of all, thanks for watching this presentation, and the topic which I will be sharing with you today is about stratigraphic interpretation using seismic attribute analysis and seismic phases classification. And before we move further into the workflow, let's first have a look at the dataset. The dataset which I will be using today is the Paradise dataset from Canada. And from the seismic time slice, we can clearly see that there's a channel coming across from the southwest towards the northeast. And besides that, we can also observe that there's a potential channel-like feature which comes across nearby it. However, it's pretty uncertain that whether this change in amplitude is actually corresponding to a stratigraphic feature, or is this just an anomaly on the seismic? Therefore, the objective of today's presentation is to first come up with a workflow to help me to identify and highlight the potential channels from my seismic dataset. And by the end of the day, I would also like to have all these identified channels being isolated out as geobodies. And in order to help me to achieve my objective, I'm basically going to use the below workflow, in which I will first run spectral decomposition to help me to highlight the potential stratigraphic features from my seismic dataset, followed by running attribute clustering workflow, in which the end result is going to be seismic volume represented by different seismic phases classes. I would then make use of this generated seismic phases classification volumes to extract my geobodies. Without further ado, let's move into the demo. As you can see here from my seismic time slice, there's a channel coming across from the southwest towards the northeast, and neighboring to it, there's also a potential stratigraphic feature which might correspond to a channel. However, as we go deeper, we can see that this feature is getting more and more ambiguous, and the uncertainty is pretty high to say that this is actually corresponding to a channel. Therefore, the first thing which I'm going to do now is to run a spectral decomposition workflow using the workflow area, in which I'm going to name my spectral decomposition workflow spectral decomposition demo. I'm basically going to use the input data based on what I'm currently displaying on my 3D viewer. And before defining the frequency range, I'm going to first look at this in inline and crossline view, in which I'm going to define my frequency range using my spectrum analysis. And based on the spectrum analysis tool, we can see that the corresponding spectrum is around 50 to 80 Hz, which is what I'm going to use to define my frequency range. As I would like to get 5 volumes in return, I'm using a frequency range of 50 to 90 and output them as frequency. And upon running spectral decomposition using the workflow approach, I will in return be getting my spectral decomposition's volumes directly being displayed on my 3D viewer. And I would now like to view the spectral decomposition volume corresponding to 50 Hz. And by looking at the time slice at 50 Hz, we can see that this spectral decomposition volume further highlights out the channel feature which I have managed to identify on the amplitude time slice. And apart from this, this other stratigraphic feature, which is pretty ambiguous on our amplitude section, has now stands out as a separate feature, which we can see that when we move down further, this is still pretty much clear on my frequent C cube of 50 Hz. And in order to improve my understanding on how my channel looks like or the potential features on my spectral decompositions, I'm now going to blend my spectral decomposition volumes using the merge mode by blending 50, 60 and 80 Hz. And I'm going to view them using RGB. And in order to have this view even better, I'm going to further play around with my red, green and blue color, in which I'm going to first intensify my red, which corresponds to 50 Hz, my green, which corresponds to 60 Hz, and my blue, which corresponds to 80 Hz. So as you can see, by just simply or easily blending these volumes together, this gives me a much better picture on how my channel should look like on my seismic data. As we can see that the main channel pretty much stands out as one channel, and this other stratigraphic feature can now be clearly seen to be much likely possible to be connected to this other part of the feature on the section of my spectral decomposition time slice. So, as now I have managed to identify my channel, I would now like to isolate them out from my seismic data as separate geobodies. But before doing this, I would like to first run an attribute clustering workflow in which I will be getting a set of seismic faces classification volume in return. And the reason of me doing this is so that this is then later going to ease my work when I'm doing my geobody detection, such as if I run my geobody detection directly using my blended spectral decomposition cube, it's going to give me much more extra information. So I'm basically going to use my spectral decomposition volumes of 50, 60 and 80 as my input data for my attribute clustering. And I'm going to limit my attribute clustering to be run only within my area of interest, in which I'm now going to restrain this process to be within the area covered by the top and bottom limits of my colony channel grids. And I'm now going to put this back into my inline and crossline, so that I can preview my interval better. So by previewing the interval, I can now know that my attribute clustering is going to be run only within this area covered by my top and bottom horizon. And as the attribute clustering workflow is basically a neural network approach, therefore, by training the data, the neural network is going to go across my input data which I have used for my attribute clustering, in which for my case here, it's going to be my spectral decom volumes. And it's going to look for the data trend with the similar trend. And it's going to further classify or categorize them based on the number of classes which I have defined here. So the end result is basically going to be a seismic faces volume, which is going to be color-coded based on the different number of classes. And the color is going to be based on what we have defined here in my classification table. As this is going to be the first pass of my attribute clustering, I'm going to use the default number of 7. And by running this, this in return will be giving me a seismic phase's volume directly being displayed on my 3D viewer or in the 3D canvas of my integrated canvas. And I'm going to further look at this in time slice. So I'm now going to quickly pan through my seismic time slice to have a feel of my resultant seismic faces cube. And from here, we can briefly have an idea that the channel is mainly corresponding to seismic faces class number 2, which is red, and a little bit on seismic faces class number 7, which is purple. And as we move deeper, we can also see that seismic faces class number 6, which is the blue one, is also corresponding to some parts of the channel. However, we can also see that class number 6 is also being scattered outside the channel, which is not really my area of interest. As one of the main aim of running the attribute clustering workflow is to later ease my work when I'm running geobody detection so that I can easily identify my channel based on a predominant class, such as I'm expecting that the channel is going to be classified based on a predominant class or being color-coded by a specific color. I'm now going to reduce my number of classes. So what I'm expecting here is a much cleaner result from what I'm currently seeing with the number class of 7. So once the process has completed, I'm now going to pan through again my seismic faces volume. And as I would also like to have a quick look or have a feel of my channel in a 3D view, such as to have an idea on how my channel will trend, I would also like to run this or look at this using my volume rendering. And in order to view this in a rendered volume, I can now move on to change this into the volume rendering mode. And from here, we can see that by moving across my rendered volume, it seems like class number 1, which is the dark maroon color, doesn't really correspond to my channel. Therefore, I'm going to play around a bit with my threshold by removing class number 1, such as I'm going to use a minimum number of 2 as my class. And as I move deeper, we can also see that class number 4, which is the blue, seems to be corresponding to the channel. And class number 3, which is the green, seems to be covering the area outside the channel. So I'm now coming to move into my opacity and remove my class number 3. So let's have a quick look again by moving through our channel. And as we move deeper into the section, we can see that class number 2 totally stands out to represent my channel, which is color coding it in orange color. So I'm now also going to remove out my class number 5. And from here, we can also further highlight out the channel, which seems to be predominantly being categorized by class number 2. So therefore, I decided to remove out class number 4 as well and increase my class number 2. So from here, I can now have a quick feel on how my channel will look like in a 3D view. and by putting on a separate block, which I'm going to then change this into time slice, and then snaps this back towards my gel body. And put back in my spectral decomposition. So I can now confidently see that there's two set of channels and my gel body, which I'm going to extract out later on from my rendered volume, is basically made up of two set of channels, in which this channel here is going to be corresponding to one set of channel, and this rendered volume here, which I'm going to extract or isolate out using my gel body detection method, is going to be my channel number two. So once I have now identified or have isolated this out using the volume rendered mode, I'm now going to perform a gel body detection to extract out this information from my seismic so that they can be a standalone body by itself. And to do this, I'm now returning back to my workflow area and to create another gel body detection workflow. As I would like to restrict my input data to be using the rendered volume, I will now come and remove my block number 2. And I'm going to directly use my rendered volume as my input, in which you can see that by using this option, it's going to directly suck in my rendered volume as my input data. And I'm now going to plant my seeds, or to pick my seeds, to extract out this isolated body as gel bodies. And I'm going to use a minimum range of 2 and a maximum range of 2 for my gel body detection, so that the workflow is basically to only restrain the detection to be within the class number 2, which corresponds to my channel bodies. And by doing this, this is going to save us a lot of time later on to remove all the extra information which we don't really need. And as this is the first pass of my gel body detection, I'm only going to do a single body detection. And I would also like to output my gel bodies as tessellated surface, or what is called T-surface in Paradigm. So as you can see here, the resultant gel body is pretty good, I would say, as it seems like it follows pretty much the trend which I have planted my seed, which is actually representing the channel which I have identified based on my spectral decomposition cubes as well as my attribute clustering volumes. As based on the seismic data, we also know that there's a channel coming across, which is this one over here. I'm now moving back into my gel body detection workflow and to further plan my seed on this set of channel, which I would like to isolate out as well from my seismic data. And it's always a good practice when we are doing this is to zoom in and pick our seats to make sure that we are actually selecting at the corresponding class if you have more than one class displayed on your view, to make sure that we are actually extracting what we would like to see. And as I'm doing this on the same GeoBody detection workflow, it's going to prompt me the previous message which you see on my screen. So as you can see, my GeoBody detection result pretty much isolates out the channel which I have identified from my seismic section, and it actually follows quite well the seeds which I'm picking, and this can be done by further restrain your data range or your detection to be within the range which you are interested to detect the geobodies from, and as well as by zooming in when you are planting your seeds. So by now having these channels isolated out as separate geobodies, I can then further use them for various purposes, such as I can actually use them for my well planning as well as for volumetrics calculation. Or you can actually also just easily use them to visually or interactively use them together with your seismic data, such as if, for example, if you have a traverse like what I have here in my project, I can basically use my geobodies or visualize them together with my traverse to have a quick view or to have a better idea on what are the stratigraphic features which I'm looking here on my seismic section corresponding to. So from here, I can see that this stratigraphic feature over here is corresponding to this channel, and this stratigraphic features which I can manage to identify in my traverse over here is corresponding to this other seismic channel which I have isolated out as a geobody. So let's now move back into the presentation slides before we end this presentation. So just a quick recap on what we have gone through. So from the initial stage of the amplitude time slice where I have a very high uncertainty on the stratigraphic features which I have identified from it, I have then run spectral decomposition to further highlight or to enhance the stratigraphic features, or for my case here, my channels from my seismic data. I have then run attribute clustering workflow to further categorize these features into a specific seismic faces class, in which for my case here, it's seismic faces class number 2, which predominantly represents my channel. And by using this, I then further move on to run my geobody detection to isolate out these channels from my seismic data, in which I can then use it for well planning, volumetrics calculation, or just for simple visualizations, or interactively using it with my seismic section for QC or identification purposes. So that's all for my presentation today, and thank you for watching.